Well, hello everyone. Hi, my name is Pari and I'm a materials product manager at Formlabs. We are super excited to talk to you today about our new silicone 40A resin. And with me, I have our lead material scientist, Alex Herring, who's been leading this project. Alex, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, thanks Pari. As Pari said, I've been working on this project for the past couple of years. It's been a team effort. We have a lot of scientists working on this and it's a really exciting thing. What's unique about this is it's actually 100% silicone. There's no acrylate, there's no monomer. It's just a silicone part, which is really cool and pretty unique. So I'm excited to talk more about it.
Ooh, that is very exciting. Alex, could you tell us a little bit more about what the key properties for this silicone 40A resin are?
Sure. So as the name implies, it's a 40A durometer material, which is quite a soft material, but it's actually still pretty tough. So we get over 200% elongation at break, and we get 5 megapascal tensile strength and a tear strength of 12 kilonewtons per meter. So it's soft, but you're able to stretch it, pull on it, and it holds up quite well. In addition to that, it's got good rebound properties, so 34% rebound resilience, which means that it snaps back into place when you let go of it after you've stretched it, just like a rubber band would. Or if you drop it on the ground, it's going to bounce like we would expect a piece of rubber would.
Gotcha. Yeah, we can see our colleague Alina showing us some of those silicone parts, the stretchability and the tear strength. So super impressive material. Alex, could you also tell us a little bit more about how it compares to other 3D printed elastomers?
Sure. So like I said, this is a 100% silicone material, which is unique. Most other 3D printed elastomers on the market, especially in SLA and resin printing, are going to be some sort of a urethane-based material, which is great for some things, but it doesn't have the range of temperature stability here that we get, or the range of chemical resistance and inertness that we can get out of this. So a typical elastomer might start to feel a little bit soft and almost gummy rather than rubbery, whereas these silicone materials really feel like you'd expect a rubber piece to feel and snap right back into place.
Gotcha.
Additional to that, we have good hydrophobicity that you don't see in a lot of other materials, and you can hold up to quite a range of chemicals. Some aggressive chemicals really aren't going to hurt this stuff.
Gotcha. So the description you kind of mentioned, it sounds almost like a cast silicone. Is that what's special about this material?
That's right. It's going to perform really similar to a cast silicone. So what you've used cast silicones for in the past, you can probably 3D print and test it out with this.
Got it. And you mentioned properties like tear strength, elongation and break. So I think those are demonstrated as Elena is really stretching in these parts. Rebound resilience, what's special about that?
So that just talks about how much energy is stored by the part. So what that means is when you stretch it and then you let go, it snaps right back into place. A lot of the times, if you have a material that has a higher glass transition temperature, especially, it's going to sort of slowly come back into place. I'm sure you felt that with a piece of rubber that you bend and it slowly recovers. This one is going to snap right back to where it was before. Or if you bounce it on the ground, it's going to have some nice bounciness to it. That's because the glass transition temperature here is actually -107°C, which is what you'd expect for a silicone, but you don't see in many other 3D printed elastomers.
Absolutely. I think this is truly a class of material on its own. So that's why we're super excited by it. And speaking of excitement, I think you also had a chance to work with other internal Formlabs employees who use the silicone resin for their applications. Could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, that's right. It was pretty fun to let some of the engineers here at Formlabs play with this material before we've been able to release it to the public and see what they've been using it for. So one example of that is for button covers. You can use this silicone to print something that's going to be repeatedly pressed and pushed up against a button many times, and it's going to hold up well to that. It's not going to start to deform over time or crack over time. It's going to hold up really well in that sort of application. Some of the other applications we've seen it used for here are casting parts. So instead of actually using the silicone itself directly, you can print a mold and then you can cast with a range of materials like epoxy or polyurethane, and you can use a mold release and pull the parts out and use these again and again, which is really cool. So you can generate a lot of high quality parts with a lot of fine detail that are hard to get elsewhere.
I'm just fascinated by the two molds, the 3D printed silicone molds, and then the urethane part that's been used to cast it. So as you can see, a lot of fine details in there. And then I think you can apply mold release and get multiple parts out of this, right? It's a reusable silicone mold as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
That looks super cool. And I think we also heard about the bite valve, sort of like functional prototyping. So can you share us a little bit more about that?
Sure, yeah. So people who have worked with our printers before know that our resin gets dispensed out of a cartridge and there's a small valve at the bottom of that that's actually made with a cast silicone in production. We're doing some prototyping internally, looking at other valves. And so we helped out the team working on that by giving them some silicone to print their own bite valves to do some testing with. And they've been able to quickly iterate, whereas previously they've had to go to a, you know, an external company to request injection molded parts, and it sort of slowed things down. So there's been a lot of time savings that way.
Absolutely. I think that just speaks to the key applications and the benefits of 3D printing with silicone.
Yeah, absolutely.
And yeah, very similar to like how you've been working with our internal engineers. I've had a chance to give this material to some of our external beta testers and customers as well. And they were super excited by the applications that they were able to use it for. So Finnis, who's a leading swimwear manufacturer, so they have these swim goggle gaskets. So the one that Elena is showing right now, and the gaskets internally, so the one that the part that seals around the eye, that one is actually 3D printed in silicone. So it is it's a very nice sealing fit. So there's no water leakage through it. And then, like you mentioned, the rebound resilience earlier, the springiness or the rebound is what they really liked about that material as well.
Were they able to use this actually in real swimming application and test it out?
Which they did at, exactly. So they were able to put one of the silicone gaskets on it, and then they had another cast injection molded on the other side, and they swam with it and it performed exactly identically. So they were in the water for 2 weeks, both fresh water and salt water, and they did several laps with it. And yeah, it performed exceptionally well, and they were super impressed with it.
Well, that's great. That shows it does hold up well against, you know, caustic environments like a pool or you know, salt water. It's going to hold up, especially against aqueous chemicals like that. It's going to really do well.
Gotcha. And yeah, it was also interesting because they were now able to 3D print a part in just 8 hours. So before they were sending it out for urethane molding, which used to take 2 to 3 weeks. So they couldn't iterate through as many designs. So now they have a printed part in 8 hours. If they want to change something, they can do it the next day. And there's a lot of time savings for them in terms of product development.
That's great to hear.
Yeah, and cost savings too. Yeah, so the costs were around like $1,200 for outsourcing through casting, and then they could print the same part for around $10. So we didn't need to make too much of a case as to like why this material is going to be beneficial for them.
Awesome. Has anyone else been using it?
Yeah, another cool story is AGM Automotive. So they made these connector seals. It's the one on the, yeah, the white plastic housing, as you can see. So these cast seals are... you can see there's fine intricate geometries there, the small holes, less than a quarter inch in diameter. So wires go through those as well. And then it's very difficult to actually cast it and get repeatable sort of like performance in these parts. They were able to 3D print 25 of those parts in one go in 6 hours. And it was not just the design complexity where 3D printing was beneficial. They actually had a chance to test it out functionally as well.
Is this used in a car? Is there a lot of heat involved with this?
Yeah, absolutely. So because these were used in engine bays, so they had it assembled and they had it undergo thermal cycling for over 6 weeks, temperatures ranging from, I think, minus 10 to around 110 degrees C or something. And then they also had splash testing with different chemicals like transmission fluids, oils, antifreeze. And like you explained, the chemical inertness is what really made them happy about this material. They were able to almost substitute their current manufacturing with 3D printing. And because their production requirements are so low, it's only 500 to 1,000 units that they need per year. They're considering just using 3D printing for these applications now.
Oh, that's great to hear about it in the end use part. That's really cool. And I think that shows the chemical resistance. It's going to perform just similarly to what you'd expect with any cast silicones you've experienced in the past, because it actually is 100% silicone. So it's just going to act the same way when it sees these chemicals.
Right. Yeah. We had a lot of other applications too, some custom seals and gaskets from Dorman. So yeah, before they were machining these metal dies that they were using to cut silicone rubbers, but now they can directly 3D print these, as you can see. There's these actuators for soft robotics that's used by robotics labs as grippers and stuff. That's the part that Alina is showing right now. The silicone boot example is very cool too. So it's a protective boot. It goes over the brake master cylinder. And that's the part that's been assembled. And then, yeah, finger prosthesis. Yeah, that's the silicone boot there, right there. So it's used to cover up the dirt and grime and oils. So it's actually our sample part too. So we're super excited by it.
I think what that shows that's kind of unique about silicone here is that with most 3D printed elastomers, when you deflect them or bend them repeatedly in an application like this, they're going to eventually start to crack in that location. Even if they hold up to it the first few times, they'll start to develop some cracks and eventually totally fail. With this silicone, we found that it really holds up robustly against repeated flexing. So we've done something called Ross flex testing, where you take a sample and you punch a notch into it that's a crack initiator, and then you flex it repeatedly. In this case, we did it over 500,000 times at negative 10 C. So a pretty aggressive situation where most elastomers that are coming off 3D printers today would get brittle. This holds up well, and there's no crack propagation and no failure at over 500,000 cycles. So this is going to hold up really well for these sorts of uses.
Repeated uses. Yeah, that I think very much speaks to like the performance of this material compared to other elastomers. Super impressive stuff. Yeah, Alex, so material's super impressive and wide variety of applications that our users have been using it for. Can you tell us a little bit more about the workflow? So what are the requirements of like printing with silicone?
Sure. So I'm happy to share that it's not too different than what people are used to if they're already in the Formlabs system. So you use a Form 3 printer, no special tank or anything like that. And when your print comes off, you're going to use a form wash just like you typically would. The only difference is going to be instead of 100% IPA, we're going to use 80% IPA with 20% butyl acetate. And that's really just to help solvate more of the silicone. Following that, there's a 60-minute drying time. And then you're going to cure it just like you normally would in a form cure. The only difference with this step is you're going to submerge the part in water prior to curing, and it's going to remain in water during the cure. After that, it's ready to go. So there's no extensive long-term curing, and there's no additional equipment that you would need.
Gotcha. Yeah, that sounds like the very streamlined workflow that I'm used to with printing with Formlab printer. So I'm excited to hear that there's not really too many deviations from it. And I think that's mostly what we had for today. So Alex, do you want to share anything else about the material or anything else that comes to mind?
I think that about covers it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're all really excited to see what different uses the silicone 48 resin will be put to. So we'll have a bunch more resources. You can please feel free to check out the links in the descriptions below. We'll have user stories, case studies. We also have a webinar that's coming up shortly that does a deep dive on silicone 48 resin. There's a link to register for that as well. And yeah, we are excited to put this resin out there and see what the world does with it. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks.